Welcome back to This Week. Time now to get the views of our media and political experts, Metro Councilman-at-Large and Democratic Operative Jerry Maynard, and her daily on 1510 WLAC syndicated talk show host, Steve Gill, chatting it up here as we go. Welcome. Nice to see you.
Let's start
with the news made today, really. The president talking about changing the contraception issue so that insurers, not the churches of who would run hospitals and other facilities, have to pay for contraception. Is this enough to quell the controversy?
I think this is a great compromise. As someone who supports the compromise, because as a pastor, even if I start a school or start a hospital, I think that I should have the right to have my religious tenets in order and not provide contraceptives if it's against my religious tenets. That the insurance company is providing that allows women to get access to health care so that they are not discriminated against because of the religious tenets of the religion they may not be a member of or a believer in. So I agree with this compromise, and I think Obama did the right thing.
I think the problem is that the White House is saying it's not a compromise, it's an accommodation. And the accommodation is they're going to force the insurance companies to provide the contraceptives, provide the abortion pills. But the hospitals, the Catholic churches, the other religious groups are still going to have to provide what they find offensive. I don't think you're going to find anybody's going to see this distinction as really being much. And the fact that the White House doesn't even want to call it a compromise, I think, is part of the problem.
Catholic bishops have not yet decided if this is enough.
They're pretty much saying today. It's not.
That must have just come out because they were saying we're not sure yet, we're going to look at it further. But again, if it's not, then it becomes a mandate where they're going to be opposed.
Well, the key is whether they're going to cover the co-pays or whether it's going to be a co-pay. So the Catholic bishops, their argument is off the table now because they were arguing that we should not have to pay for it. And by waiving the co-pays means we fully pay for it. So I don't know what the Catholic bishops are upset about right now. They get what they want. They don't have to pay for the contraceptives, and women get access to health care, which is a key fundamental point, because you have two compelling arguments. Should women have access to health care, whether they belong to the religious organization or not, or should the religious organization be able to be in line with their religious tenets? And Obama's compromise accomplishes both.
If the insurance company is paying for it and the church or religious organization is paying the insurance company, the idea that somehow they're not paying for it, particularly when they are forced to offer coverage, including abortion pills, is what should be off the table. And frankly, go back to the Obamacare debate. This is what they promised would not be happening. This is what they said they would not do. And you've got Democrats like Kathy Dalrymple, who was a congresswoman from Pennsylvania, who lost her seat thanks to her vote for Obamacare, who now says she would not have voted for it if she'd known they weren't telling the truth.
And this is the bigger issue because, as you were talking about, there is a big divide. A lot of women want this paid for because they want this coverage.
That's correct, because it's treated like second-class citizens in health care coverage and access to health care. The other thing is more important is that the churches were always exempt. The only thing that were not exempt were schools.
Hospitals and schools, daycares.
So if you engage in the market, if you engage in a market business or the business in the private market, then you should be able to treat all your employees the same way, and those employees should be, whether they're part of the religious group or not, they should have access to health care. And that was the main point.
The polls show that overwhelmingly people oppose this, particularly when you make it clear that it is not just health care, but also the providing of abortion pills. And I think that's what moves it into the overwhelming opposition. That hasn't been solved by this.
It's not called an abortion pill. It's the day after pill.
A week after gets to be longer than a day
after. And it doesn't sound like, as you're talking about, the bishops have completely finalized this. If there is continued opposition, they're saying that they may break the law and not abide by this because they feel it interferes with their religious tenets.
I again think their argument is off the table. Now they're being unrealistic, and I think that they're also being unreasonable. I think the Catholic bishops got what they wanted, and that is that they do not have to waive the copay. That's what they wanted. That was their argument. Now they can't backtrack and say, oh, by the way, we want to move the goal line again. And I want to make this point. It's not an abortion pill. It's the morning after pill. You may not be pregnant, so there's nothing to abort.
Well, I think the other bigger issue here is the whole politics. I think it's interesting you talk about backtracking by the bishops. The president last week was saying they would not compromise, they would not back up, and yet you had his chief of staff, Bill Daley, you had the vice president of the United States, Joe Biden, and others arguing against this months ago, saying this is bad politics, it's bad policy. The president arrogantly decided not to listen to any of them, and now having said, I'm going to do it my way, you have to do it my way, now he starts to back up. And I think it makes the president, from a political standpoint, not be able to push this issue back, because as soon as the election's over, they're going to come back and try to do this again.
He was listening to his constituent of women. Women were saying, we want this. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't that he was being arrogant, Steve. He listened to one constituent group, which are women. Who are the number one demographic for Democrats? Women. So he has to listen to his constituents. He wasn't just being arrogant.
Here in Tennessee, not a great week for the governor as he proposed tying funding of schools to increasing class sizes. Overwhelming oppositions. 80% of school superintendents said, we do not want this. We do not want larger classes. The governor and the speaker now saying, well, it's up for discussion, it's up for debate. It's not necessarily set in stone. He backtracked on this pretty good.
Well, he had a better week than Mitt Romney. Yes, you made him so low on the pattern. Right. So by that standard, maybe he did okay. I think, again, this was one where you wonder, what were they thinking before they did the policy? I'd say the same thing about the White House. You know, you might want to talk to some people before you come out with a contraceptive policy that's going to antagonize the Catholics or an education policy that apparently nobody wants.
In fact, every expert states that you have to have smaller class sizes for teachers to be effective. For you to say, we want you to be able to lay off teachers and increase class sizes, and that somehow is going to be your education reform, just was ridiculous. And I'm so happy that the governor said, you know, we're going to rethink this and we're going to reconsider this, because the right thing to do is we need to decrease class sizes, hire more teachers, in fact, in order to improve our schools.
A win for the governor this week. The administration, the Obama administration, did waive Tennessee and nine other states from No Child Left Behind. This seems like a good thing because the requirements made schools fail. There was a stigma here that they could not meet, and there are going to be local requirements that do increase the standards.
And, Bob, you're very right, because our school systems were getting better, and then the administration raised the standards even higher. So even though we're improving, we're getting up to this area, then you raise the standards higher again, so therefore it would look like we were failing when really we're making improvements. Our schools are the ones who won. I mean, yeah, Governor Haslam is a winner, but our school systems are the real winners here.
I think the problem is to declare it a win when you still have 50 to 60% of the students who are not performing at the level they're supposed to perform to meet those standards. Yeah, those standards were going up, but the fact that we're not meeting them means we suddenly stop measuring. It's because we don't want to know how bad we're doing. That to me seems like it's a failure for our students, a failure for our schools. If we are not meeting the standards, it's not a matter that the standards are too high, it's that we are not doing what it needs to be done in our schools, when again, 50 and 60% of our kids can't read, can't do math at the right level.
The waiver should not be permanent. The waiver should be temporary to allow us to catch up, to do our assessments, to do our evaluations, and to see if we can continue to improve. I don't believe that we should have the waiver forever, Bob, and I agree with Steve. You have to do measures. You got to measure the outcomes. You got to measure your teachers, measure and evaluate and see whether they're being effective.
But we've been making that progress only because this standard was coming and a deliver or fail date was coming. Now that we've moved that off, I'm not sure you're going to continue to see the progress.
Steve Gill, Jerry Maynard, appreciate your time and your insight. Stay with us. This week continues in a moment.